it's your girl, DeShonda Carter, but you can call me DC. Thanks so much for tuning in today to my show, When the Blue Comes Off. Sit back, relax, take notes, do what you like, and let's get into it. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome my very special guest, retired New York City Department of Correction Captain, Miss Debra Walla. Right.
How are you?
I'm great. Thank you so much for coming on the show. I know it's so hard to get you. You're such a busy woman. I appreciate your time. Because I know you have a phenomenal story, and this is so important for me to get those stories out. So we're going to just jump into it. So when I came on the job, guys, Walla was the instructor. Like, she was an instructor in the academy. And I kind of had a little idea of who she was because my mom, who preceded me in corrections, you know, I think they worked together a little bit in Rosie's. So I had, you know, some idea of who this woman was, but I did not know the magnitude of the boss badass that she was as an instructor. Not only was she an academy instructor, she was a range instructor. So she's all about them guns and that life. But before we get into it, we're going to just say welcome again. And here's the first question. What made you decide to go into the law enforcement field?
Oh, wow. What made me go into the law enforcement field? First, I got to laugh at that. Because when I did decide to go into law enforcement field, it was all about getting out early, pension, mm-hmm. and money, finances.
Right.
To be honest with you, I was making 3 times the amount of money before I went into correction. So when I got my first correction check, I actually cried. Like, what am I supposed to do with this? Oh, my God. This is all I'm making every 2 weeks?
Right.
What am I supposed to do with this? Because I had a mortgage before I went into correction.
Right.
So what basically made me really take corrections was the pension and the medical. Because although I was making a lot of money before corrections, mm-hmm. I didn't have great benefits.
Okay.
So what made me really take corrections was looking at the end game. I can retire with great benefits, great medical, and a great pension, which I needed the medical.
So that was the only interest and desire. If it wasn't for that, that would not have possibly been an avenue that you would have went down.
No, my dad was in law enforcement. I had a lot of family members in law enforcement, and I wasn't keen with it because I was basically a huge administrative person.
Okay.
So one of those kids that excelled in a class where you type 96, 95 words a minute. Everybody wanted in the office. They wanted you to do this, create this form. Can you fix this computer? I'm having troubleshooting with this. You know, so I was basically a huge administrator before I came onto the job in law enforcement. And law enforcement was the total opposite of what I was doing.
So now when you got there, coming from an administrative background, now you had to go through the academy. Now, how different was it for you to go through the academy versus how it was when you was an instructor?
Okay. Going through the academy for myself was an experience. I'm going to put it that way. Because back when we was coming on, they was treating us like military people, mm-hmm. basically. And like when you go and join the Marines or the Army, and they was like that strict discipline and that strict, you know, in your face, yelling and screaming and calling you all kinds of derogatory names. And you just had to be that strong person to get over that hurdle. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, I'm not stupid, or I'm not this, or I'm not on welfare. I'm not, you know, you had to get over that hurdle of those negative names that they was throwing at you, which is what was their style back then. It's no longer their style, thank God, because mm-hmm. half the people that fell out just along on that. But, you know, you had to be that strong individual to say, like, these names don't hurt me. I know my worth, and this is what I'm going to do. So it was a lot different. Now, in the academy as an instructor, I knew not to do that to my recruits because I wanted them to be the best. and wanted them to know the real deal before they stepped out into that field and got themselves hurt or indicted or, you know, in trouble. Right. My goal as an instructor was to keep everybody that I encounter and I train out of trouble.
Well, we appreciate you. I think I did good coming through. I didn't get into too much trouble, but I think I did good. So after you came out the academy, where did you go? At what was your first facility, and what was that like for you? Although you had family members that were in law enforcement prior, did you expect what you expected upon arrival into the facility?
When them door closed behind you and you the only one in a room with 150 detainees and they all males, your heart drops to the floor. But you can't let them see you sweat.
And guys, if y'all don't know, Walla's a little thing. She's kind of short. I'm short, but I think she's a little shorter than me. And let me.
I'm 5'1".
Yeah, so you thought, yeah, I'm 5'5". And you are 5'1". So imagine this woman commanding a room of 150 people. And people don't necessarily know that back in the days the department had that massive amount of people. People think the housing, when you say, oh, I'm in a dorm with 30 inmates, that's like, what?
What?
Are you crying?
What? That's all? You in a dorm with 50 inmates, so I had triple that amount. Exactly. We had them double timed in the gym. Their whole dormitory was the entire gym when we came on. They had bunk beds in the gym because there was no room for them.
What was your first facility?
Well, I went into NIC,
okay,
which was attached to JATC. So we were technically both at that time because NIC was being built. So everything we needed was in JATC. So we had to go back and forth. If we wanted to eat, we had to eat in JATC. When alarms went off in JATC, guess who responded? We did. We had to suit up and run over to JATC for that. So, I mean, basically, we were in NIC, but we worked for JATC. And then from there, you know, I just went bounced around to all the different facilities on Rikers Island.
Right. So now after you got your foot wet, your feet wet, you're getting, you know, accustomed to this law enforcement lifestyle. On a bad day as an officer, when you first came in, did you really have a lot of bad days then? Because I feel like the camaraderie in law enforcement back then was much greater than today.
We had a lot of unity back then. So even if we didn't like each other, when the shit went down, we were meshed together. So it wasn't, we were like, we're all a sea of blue and we're going to stick together regardless of our differences.
Right.
Different colors, different sex, different size, didn't matter. When the shit hit the fan, we were all there together, you know, doing that battle. And the unity was much greater than it is today. I don't think the department has any unity at all right now. Mm-hmm. Because with unity, there comes strength.
Right.
And we stuck together. Even the captains band together with the officers. So there was no difference.
Right.
Like, when you as an officer and you had to write your first report, that white shirt sat down with you and made sure the shit was right before you handed it to them.
Absolutely. And I can attest to that, because when I was a captain, the officers were bringing, I'm like, no, we're gonna change this. No, you gotta fix that. Because even though you're supposed, and I think that's proper supervision. Like, you don't want to see your officer get burned because you know they didn't check the right box, or they forgot, they omitted a line that should have been in there. You know what I mean? So,
or they didn't explain themselves on paper like they did verbally.
Right.
Like, they can tell you the scenario verbally, explain it to you verbally where it makes sense. But when it was time to put pen to paper, it came out totally different. And you'd be like, wait a minute, that ain't what you told me. And that is going to get you in trouble.
Right.
So I would pull a senior person and go, I would tell a senior person what I needed that report to say. I wouldn't say it directly to that individual that's writing the report.
Right.
Why? Because there was no unity. So they would give you up in a heartbeat if they felt like a little heat was coming on them.
Mm-hmm.
They'd be like, well, Cam so-and-so told me to write that.
Right.
And that was what, you know, you trying to assist them from helping them getting out of trouble, they'd be able to put that weight on your leg and drag you right down. So I never discussed what needed to be changed to an officer. I would pull a senior officer to the side and tell them, you need to review this report. Or I would pull their you know, their union delegate. And right. like, yep, if they hand this in, they get in trouble. So this is what you need to do. And I would explain to them what they need to do, what needs to be changed, what needs to be added, what needs to be said to keep them from getting in trouble. And they would speak to the officer and tell the officer that.
So what would you say was your better? Did you enjoy being an officer more or a captain?
Wow. I had two totally different experiences in corrections, being a supervisor than being an officer. With an officer, oh, we laugh, we joke, we was on posts, hanging out, making all kinds of noise on the midnight, staying up with the MACs yelling, yo, CO, go to sleep, man. Like, we was just crazy wild on the midnight just to keep ourselves up all night. We was laughing and joking and just, it wasn't even about the party, and it was just the type of people that you had in your circle, the people that were in your squad that you saw every day when you wheeled, because
mm-hmm.
we were on the wheel. It was nothing steady, unless you were senior, then you would get something steady. But as a new officer, you wheeled. You didn't come and get no steadies. That was unheard of. So whatever squad you was in, those same people that you rotated in and did overtime with, those are the people that you bonded with.
Right.
And you created a secondary family with.
Well, nowadays, you know, the officers come in, they don't want to wheel. They like, no, I've been here 6 months. I've been, I'm supposed to have a steady and, you know.
No, I've been here 2 weeks. I need a steady.
And they needed five and twos and they needed day two.
Oh, I'm going to call Chief so-and-so because that's my hook. You never gave up your hook. If you had a hook, you never gave your hook up. You never threw your hook's name around. You never did nothing to make your hook look bad.
Absolutely.
But nowadays, please, they'll throw the hook under the bus.
So now tell me about the captain part. So when you said officer, you was having a good time. You kept the inmates up on the overnight.
What was
the experience as the captain?
Letting go of being an officer. That was a hard transition because, you know, we were hands-on as officers. Mm-hmm. Everything was about taking care of business, doing everything for the captain. So that way when the captain walk on post, all they got to do is sign our paperwork.
Right.
Do the tours. The captains only get called if there was a serious issue. And the detainees did not talk to our supervisors when we were on post. Right. You talk to me first.
Right.
If you don't talk to me and you go straight to my captain, the whole house get locked down, shut down.
Right.
Nope. We ain't doing that.
Oh, please. So well, they're not talking to the captains no more. They bypassing. They talking to the wardens. The wardens and the chiefs is coming to the housing area. Look, I need to speak to Chief so-and-so. Okay?
Yeah, well, if the chief comes without clearing it with the underranks under him, then he working too hard. He let go of his underranks either. You understand? So that was the part of letting go as a supervisor. When you become a captain, you have to transition and let the officers do their job.
Now, was there a difference in being a captain in the facility versus being the captain in the academy, the correction academy?
Okay, the captain in the facilities I did, even if I was a captain in the academy, because we got redeployed so much. We was in the field more than we was at the academy.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody knows that. They just thought we was just assigned to the academy and we never went nowhere. No, we got redeployed 2 and 3 times a week. Whenever they were short supervisors, whatever jail it was in, that's where we got redeployed. I basically stayed at GRBC, OBCC, and 95 when I got redeployed as a captain.
Oh, wonderful jails.
Yeah. I loved them. I loved them. And I made all my money off of them, too. And 76, too. 76, they would call me. All the depths would call me because they knew if there was a report that needs to be done or a package that needs to be done, I took care of my package in 2 days. I got rid of my package. I didn't hold on to it because I never knew what the next day was going to bring me. So that's the different experience between an officer and a supervisor. The officers is what's going to make you work.
Mm-hmm.
As an officer, you know that your housing area, as long as you have your housing area in order, you're not really going to work. So, which means your supervisor that has that area doesn't have to work because you got everything under control. But if you got lazy officers behind you, you as a supervisor, you're going to work twice as hard. So that was the difference between officer and captains. You had to transition out of that, oh, I'm an officer, I'm going to do it myself. But then the depths be like, that's the officer's job to write that injury report, to write that infraction over so that it sticks. Not your job. You give it back to them and you make them do it.
Right.
So I felt like I was doing the instructing as a captain in the field, working in the jails when I first got promoted. I was doing more rewriting reports and rewriting rainbow packages and stuff, even for the depths. Mm-hmm. Then I said, well, I'm just doing this all for one jail. I just need to go back to the academy so I can get everybody right. And help everybody instead of that just one jail. So that was the difference between being a captain in the jail and then being an instructor captain at the academy. Because I felt like I could reach more than one person. So I went back to the academy. And I started training the supervisors and the officers that report writing, that importance to keep them out of trouble.
Absolutely. And I think that's very important that people understand what they go through the academy. And we know that, you know, you learn the basics and the foundation in the academy. Because you have to implement. When you get into the facility, it's different. But the skill set and knowledge base is still there. So you have to get that foundation. And I think a lot of it is that the instructors, and I can't say because I'm not there, but I think that the instructors are just, you know how like elementary school in New York City, the educational system, you know, they're pushing them through, you know.
I'm glad you said that. Because I definitely got a comment about that. Because you know why? They are pushing them through. Because of the person running the academy at that particular time, this mm-hmm. is why I left. I retired.
Okay.
Be honest with you. This is why I just, like, I'm not doing it. I have vicarious liability. I'm not getting caught up in no mess that, oh, I trained these recruits this when I didn't. Right. You want me to lie about that?
Right.
In court? Yeah, no, that's not going to happen. So I didn't want to get caught up in what the academy was turning out to be. Okay. So I left. I retired. And that was the purpose of me retiring. Because they were just pushing them through. And they were skipping a lot of important classes that they needed for the foundation, as you said,
right.
for them to do the basic fundamentals of corrections. They were missing that left and right. And the super the full depth and the warden in charge at that time was not hearing it. Us, when we would sit down and have our weekly staff meet, and it was like, just get it done. How are we going to get it done if y'all are requiring X amount of time for this and X amount of time for that? How are we going to get this 3-hour block lesson plan done in an hour and a half? Right. Please explain that to me. This lesson plan is written for 3 hours, but you want me to teach it in an hour and a half.
And then wonder why they come through and don't have the skill set that's needed.
Right. So we was trying to get them to extend, like they would extend their weeks there, but it was for nonsense. It wasn't for the initial important training that they needed to either protect themselves with writing or protect themselves from everything else that's going on in this department, in the department. And I just was I started getting real unhappy with it. And like I said, we've had staff meeting after staff meeting, and our female in charge, you know, she was the lead in charge. She was like one of those, I don't care, just get it done. And everything went downhill from that. And so, people started leaving. All the senior people saying, nah, I'm not doing this. I'm not doing this. I'm not going to jeopardize another kid. That can be my daughter. That can be my son, you know?
Right.
So, you know, as we get older in our career and we look at these young recruits, we look at them as our kids. Because
mm-hmm.
those can be our kids coming on. Do you want them to have the lack of knowledge base training just to do the fundamentals and wind up getting hurt? They have no skill set. And that was the thing, rushing them through, they fell shooting, make them pass. It's like, wait, what?
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, wait, this 4-hour block lesson plan is reduced to 1 hour. You only have one period to teach 4 hours, a 4-day block. I'm sorry, this 4-day block, you got 1 day to teach it. I'm like, no, that's not the way it works.
And that's, you know, it had to be a lot of pressure on you, too, because as you see them go through the academy, in the back of your mind, it's like, yo, these recruits are not ready.
They're not. And a lot of them showed that when they got in within the first month or two of their career, they got caught up.
Mm-hmm.
They got caught up, and it was very unnecessary, because then after a while, they was like, okay, so now you got to go down in court, and you have to testify that this person got this training. I will not.
Right.
I will not purge myself in court. So you need to find somebody else to do that, because I'm not going to do it. So I wasn't that person's best friend, because I refused to set that new officer. I didn't know the officer. They were no kin to me, but I still felt like me going down there and telling that fabricated lie about what we do at the academy, the onus is on me.
Right.
And I didn't feel like I'm going to mess up somebody else's life or career or even have them indicted for something that they really had no knowledge of.
And that must have been weighing on you. That's, I can tell that the way that you're speaking about it, you're very passionate about it. So I can only imagine it had to be, while you were in it, it had to be a lot of pressure on your spirit about this is not going to work.
Right. And then they wanted us to take the lesson plans and rewrite the lesson plans. Because, you know, as being an instructor, it's not just about getting in front of the class and singing and dancing and you know, tap dancing. It's about writing lesson plans, okay, doing the research to put together a lesson plan. So you have to have the knowledge base to do that as well. The topic, and then all of the subtopics, and then write the final, you know, that they got to take behind that lesson plan. You have to put all that together as a supervisor, as well as an officer. Some of the officers wrote lesson plans too in the academy.
So,
and I was on the team for that. So it's like,
So y'all put in some work. So we put a lot of people say, oh, they don't do no work. They at the academy. They chilling. They ain't doing it. They ain't getting it in. But little do they know, huh?
Little do they know. Every administrative job in the Department of Corrections is not a sit-on-ass job. If you working in programs, you busting your ass. If you working in security, you busting your ass. It's nothing to just sit down and, oh, I'm not doing nothing. Oh, I work in personnel, so I'm not doing nothing. No, you working in personnel, you working 10 times harder than a person sitting on post. I'd rather just go sit on post where I got to count inmates, do a count.
Right.
And make sure my count is right. Because the work that you do is thankless. And the intake, and, you know, the GO, when you're doing the
movement,
the movement mm-hmm. and personnel and programs and security and
admin corridor,
all of that, and then when you're the captain inside the bubble that's in charge of the whole entire jail
control room,
the control room captain, like, you are working 10 times harder on those positions than you are anywhere else. And people just think, oh, I'm going to get an admin post and I'm just going to sit on ass. No, you got deadlines. You got requirements that is required by people. People are always calling on you last minute. Oh, this needs to be done like tomorrow.
Right.
Okay, well, the captain had 2 weeks to do this report and you only giving me 2 hours to get it done?
Mm-hmm.
To get it redone? How does that work? But that's what's required of you when you're working in the back office over there.
Did you have a preference in terms of working in the academy itself or at the range? And I know it's under one umbrella, but it's still kind of like two entities. So how did you cope with being at the Metropolitan office versus the range? And which one did you prefer, if any?
Well, the range is a totally different animal. Even though, like you said, it's under one umbrella, it was always... they wanted to be their own separate entity. Now, I used to work at the range as an officer as well. Okay. And then I got promoted to captain. Then I went back to the range to run the range.
Right.
But the people that were there when I was there as an officer, they were troublesome. they were my thorns until they realized that I was not backing down. This is what I want. This is what I require from you. And as long as you give me what we require, we can have a good day.
Mm-hmm.
And once they woke up and accepted me as a female supervisor up there, everything went smooth.
Because it was ran by the boys for a very long time.
Very long time.
There was no women up there.
You saw there was very limited females up there.
Yeah.
Very limited females up there. On one hand, I could count all the females that was up there. And when I came on, there was two females up there. That was it.
I don't even really remember having a female take us out on the line.
No.
To be honest with you.
You came out, because I was in the academy at the time. When you came on, there were no females instructors up there. It was only males. Because after the two females left after I came on the job, they left shortly after I came on the job. They were never replaced with females. They were all replaced with males.
Mm.
So when I was asked to go up there for diversity purposes, I said, absolutely not, because I knew what my challenge was. I worked up there as an officer. I said, you would have to revamp the whole range. You would have to give me all new instructors.
Because
I already knew I was going to clash and bump heads with those guys up there. In which I did a few of them. And they like to do the correction setup thing. You know how it is. Everybody tried to get this person in trouble. That I call that the correction setup. That's what they do. But they couldn't get one over me. Because nobody writes better than I do. So that didn't work for them. And they just gave up. They was like, you know what? I'm not going to bump heads with her no more. It's just easier just to give in. Give her what she want. She want us in uniform at roll call. She want us all to carry a radio. She want us on the line an hour after the tour start. And she want us all to pitch in to help each other out.
That sounds like teamwork.
Hello. And that's all I required of them. And after the job was done and the class went out to lunch, everybody could put their feet up. When they realized that that was my regimen and that was my system and my system worked, everybody wanted to come on my tour now. Because they was like, no, Captain Waller, when she's on, everything runs like clockwork. No,
mm-hmm.
I don't want to work on it. Everything is chaotic here. One person is doing everything on the other tours. I said, I'm not having that. If I have eight people here, I want eight people in that room doing inspection, including myself. And I'm the ninth person. So I lead by example.
Well, you know, I just want to say thank you again for being the great supervisor and instructor that you were, that helped me, enable me to come through at a time. Because I always said my instructors at the academy was like the dream team. I mean, Barry, Felton, Isaacs, you, Adamus.
Felton ran that academy.
Oh, she was no joke.
She did not take no shorts on any of the training. She was not having that. She was not having, there was no show. And I got to tell you, me and Felton did not get along. But I give props where props is due. She ran that academy. She did not put up with the recruit shenanigans. She did not put up with the officer shenanigans. And she did not put up with anybody saying, oh, well, they got to add these classes and there's no space. Well, then you got to give me an extra day with them. Because I'm not adding this and taking away from this. There's nothing I can remove that would make their training better just to add this. And she was adamant about it. So she got the extra days attached to the recruit classes when they had extra stuff that needed to be mandated by the court. So she didn't play that, oh no, just tell them you did the training and that. Mm-mm, she didn't play that.
Also, we're going to take a quick break and come right back because I want to touch on something about Barry and Felton as soon as we come back. So, ladies and gentlemen, don't go anywhere. We're going to come right back with our New York City retired captain, Miss Deb Waller. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
This has been brought to you by Simply Carter Corp., your one-stop shop for all of your entertainment and party needs. Contact Simply Carter Corp. for any special occasion. You can find them on Facebook at Simply Carter Corp., on Instagram at Simply Carter Corp. You can check out their website at www.simplycartercorp.com. Give them a call at 845-682-0022, or you can shoot them an email at hello@simplycartercorp.com. Simply Carter Corp., a brand for everyone.
Welcome back, guys. We are here with the one, the only, the beautiful New York City Department of Correction retired Captain Debra Waller. Now, we were talking about the academy, and I just wanted to touch base on, I remember in the academy when I think during my time there, both Barry and Waller got, I mean, Barry and Felton got promoted. And when I came out of the academy, they ended up both being with me in OBCC. Felton ends up being the warden. Barry ended up being my full, was he AD Deb? What was he? He went back there as a Deb.
AGW at the academy.
Right, because he ended up coming to OBCC. And I'm going to tell you, that those two at the time coming out was like everything you needed because I was still familiar because I had just left them in the academy. So it kind of felt like home. You know what I mean? So right. It was an easy transition for me. But enough of me. Let's wrap this DOC thing up. If you had someone to come to you today and say, hey, I just passed the test. They called me. I'm going into the next academy class. What's your advice to that young person? Would you encourage them or what advice would you give them?
I would definitely encourage them, but I will also encourage them on the lines of trust your gut instinct and trust yourself. Your DOC friends are not your DOC friends. They are acquaintances. They are coworkers. That's it. Friendship goes out the window when the shit hits the fan. So you need to stand on your own two feet.
But you would encourage them to take the position.
Exactly. I would, because it, at the end of the day, you got to look at the benefits. Yes, it's very hard work right now, and that's only because of the way that they made it. There's no unity there. The union is not as strong as it should be. The captain's union is not as strong as it should be or needs to be. But between the captains and officers, if they band together, DOC couldn't stop them. Mm-hmm. And they need that unity. They need that old school camaraderie that we used to have back in the days when we came on in the 80s.
Well, DOC was good to me, but I just hate to see the direction that it's going right now. My significant other still works there. So, like, the things that are going on, I just be like, I want to go back because I feel like they don't have a voice. Like, somebody is not advocating for them. And it's just like, you know, I hope and pray that everything does turn out well. These stories are basically to encourage other people and, you know, also for the senior officers and the people who have gone on to reminisce, because someone listening to you can be like, I remember that. Yeah, that, you know, so it's a good feeling when we can talk about our lives and we made it through. We did our careers and made it through the trenches and came out to be successful people and to continue doing other things. Like right now, you are the bomb because you have a security company. So let's talk about that. Now that your blue is off, you rocking. Well, technically, does your staff wear uniforms?
We're in suits.
Okay, so they fly. So we're not in a uniform. Okay. So tell the people about what you're doing now that you've taken off the white shirt and you donned a whole new career.
Okay. I've always worked for myself during Department of Corrections. We call it private contracting, where you put yourself out for hire and people hire you and pay you on a 1099. Well, that's where I decided, okay, let me develop my company, DW Security Enterprises. And I put it under enterprises because I wanted to do more than just personal bodyguard.
Mm-hmm.
Personal executive protection or executive driving. That was the basis of it. But then I said, people still want me to do training. So I still help people with firearm related issue training. Oh, I can't pass. If I don't pass, I don't keep my job. So I take them to the range and I work with them and I help them pass. Most of the times I don't charge anything because I have a passion and love for it. So I just go out and do it. And they either wind up taking me to dinner or something like that, you know, trying to, 2 free tickets to movies so I could take whoever I want. But I haven't taken it on as a monetary thing.
Okay.
I worked for a couple of security company where I actually did their armed guard training. So I did get paid for that. That I did get paid. But when it's somebody that comes to me personally that knew me from DOC, or they send me their kid and they knew me from DOC, I don't charge them. I just go, all right, don't worry about it. I'll get them up and they'll be passing. Don't worry about it. My sister actually worked for a different security company, and she actually brought me 9 people that were retired from DOC, but they couldn't pass their qualification for this security company, and they were about to lose their jobs, all of them. So I took them to the range, and I worked with every last one of them, and they all passed, and now they still supervisors now for this security company. So that's some of what I did once I retired. I threw myself still into training because I just have a passion for training. I love teaching people and learning, too, at that.
So you didn't leave that mentality. You are still doing what you are passionate about, and I love that about you. But let me ask you, security is a male-dominant industry, just like, you know, at one point correction was, but I would say right now was more female dominated. But how do you manage to overcome, if any, obstacles? Like, you know, do you feel, I mean, even though it's 2023, do you feel like the men still kind of look at us as women in a position of power or control in these type of positions in these type of companies, like that you can't do it?
Yes. There are a lot of security companies out there right now, and I hope they hear this, that will not hire a female because she's a female. So they think a long time, oh, well, I need a executive protection or a bodyguard or somebody to do this personal security detail, but I want a male. I don't want a female. Well, some females do the job better than the males. That's why DOC did turn predominantly females, because when it was all males, it was a lot of fighting. So they figured if they bring more females in, we have that common sensation.
Mm-hmm.
That when stuff rises, we have a way of bringing the detainees down a couple of notches so that we can get through to them through communications. So then they decided to add more females for that purpose.
Right.
Well, the security field in the private industry has not gotten to that point. They are still very male dominant. And there's a lot of discrimination when it comes down to giving or hiring. Their hiring practices need to be looked at.
Because but is that not illegal? I mean, wouldn't that be, like, if I go to a company, can they say to me, and I guess they probably wouldn't say, but in the back of their minds or behind closed doors, they can't say, well, we're not hiring this person because they, you're a female, but I don't know. I feel like some of them will just be like, no, we need a woman, a man for this job. Like, do they blatantly say it?
Say that. They do blatantly say it. And then some behind closed doors, because, you know, most of the times that I'm dealing with hiring on the private level, I'm still in a supervisory position. So I get to hear the backdoor conversations, and it irritates me to the point where, you know, I never keep my mouth shut when I see someone picking on the underdog. Right. And I feel like, you know, you never gave that person a chance to know what their skill set is. Don't look at the cover. Open the book and read it.
Right, because, you know, like you said, sometimes, and I'm not going to lie, I was an intake captain, like, my whole career. From the time I got promoted, my first assignment was Rose M. Singer's intake. And then when I did
that was
over...
wasn't it? I've had my experience with Rosensinger intake, and those girls in there, they do not play. If you had the same crew I had,
no, let me tell you, those intake officers were there, like, since my mom, most of them were still there, like, when my mom used to be there, and then there was a couple that was part of the newer regime. But let me tell you, Rosie's intake was the bomb. They basically trained me as a captain, and it made my transition into going into headquarters. And
impeccable girls. Those girls were on the money in there. I sat back there and was like, oh, here we go, another new white shirt. They're going to want to, oh, because they're a white shirt, they don't want to be told what to do. I said, let me tell all of y'all something. This is your house, and I'm the visitor.
Right.
So y'all, even though I got this white shirt on, I still don't know what the fuck I'm doing in here. So I'm going to move when y'all tell me to move. How about that?
And that's a fact. That's a fact. They damn sure ran it.
Your house. Not mine. I'm a visitor here. So I go on y'all court. When it was time to discharge, these girls did my discharge paperwork. They said, don't worry, Cap. Just sign it. Because after we get them out, we're going to sit down and we're going to explain all of this shit to you. And that's exactly what they did. I'm like, oh, God, I'm signing stuff. I don't know what the fuck I'm signing. But right. I'm signing because girls said, sign it. Sign here, Cap. Sign here, Cap. Sign here. Okay, get this bitch out of here. Sign right. here. Sign here. Sign here. And that's what they did. So they moved like 75 to 100 girls on a discharge out. The intake got quiet. They was like, come on, Cap, get your notepad, let's go. And I sat there and they was like, this is how you add this up. This is how you make sure this is right. That's how you know you're discharging the right person. They broke that down to whatever the academy couldn't teach me, they taught me.
And that is a fact. And I am very grateful. At first, like when I got promoted, I wanted to go back to OBCC because I was an officer there. I was like, that's my home. I want to go back there. But I'm going to tell you that I was very adamant about not working with the females. I was like, I don't want to go there. I don't want to be there with them. They horrible. And then on top of it, I took the intake.
And Felton purposely sent me there. I requested to go to CPSU. I volunteered to go to CPSU. And it was like, no, you're part of the old JTC crew. You're not allowed. But I said, send me anywhere I'll write this except for the women. And Felton made sure I went with them women.
But it was the best training that I could have possibly had because I was able to learn at a slower pace and really learn my craft. And I think if I would have went to OB or 95, I mean, those captains that got promoted with me, they had no choice. They were getting 3 and 4 packages a week, like bong, 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 bong. And I was like getting like 3 and 4 packages a month. You know what I'm saying? So
it was slow when you came on as a captain. When I came, they were pulling wigs off of captains' heads and punching decks. So we was getting packages every week. At least 2 or 3 packages every week.
No, I was very grateful in my career, and I would not change a thing. I mean, unfortunately, toward the latter part of my career, I felt like, you know, a lot of things were changing, and it was just, you know, you're locking up chiefs and captains and for doing
it. It was time to go.
I said, this isn't for me anymore, and I bounced. But To wrap it up, if you were to have someone coming to the transition from law enforcement into the security field, who's a woman? Is there any special any special information you would give them into terms of like help them become an ideal candidate for that position? Because it's so difficult to obtain, like, and really get the respect in that field.
Well, I would say a lot of training is necessary, because when you're on for, if you're in a city agency or a federal agency or a state agency and you plan on retiring, just make sure that your resume is solid with a lot of different training, different things that you've done within your career in that department or within that agency that you're getting ready to retire out of. So if you can get your CDL, get your CDL. Right. If you get an armed guard license, get that while you're active, because it's so much easier, so much quicker, and you don't have to pull that money out of your pocket. Same thing with a CDL. If you can get additional training like executive protection or some tactical training or something like that to build your resume up, I would suggest that they would go and get all of those various different trainings. Now, a lot of people already have it in their head. Once I leave the blue, I'm never going back to doing any type of security or anything like that. I'm going to go be a teacher, or I'm going to go be a nurse or something like that. Hats off to them. But for most of the times when you leave that job that you retire from, you go back into that civilian feeling, that same aura, that same circle. Right. So what you need to build that resume, regardless if you think you're going to use it or not, because you never know. It can come in handy when somebody calls and go, well, do you have this? Do you have that? And I would like to hire you for $50 or $75 an hour. And then you're scrambling trying to get an armed guard license or right. something like that.
Right.
You know, and by that time you try to get that, the job done passed you. Because a lot of opportunities out here in the civilian work field, you got to snatch them up right away. Because once they come, it doesn't last forever.
Right. Especially the way things are going now in the city. You know, the inflation is high, yeah. You know. And one thing you said earlier in the interview about, you know, the benefits, the pension, cost of living is going to keep going up. So mm-hmm. even if you have a pension, and if you came on this job and you actually did your 20, let's not. Talk about the 25s or the 30 years. No matter the amount of time you did, I don't care what anyone says. You're still young and vibrant. You're not yes. You're not a retiree like 70, 80. And even 70-year-olds are still popping, okay?
Yep,
so you're
yep.
not 80 years old where you're sitting at home in the rocking chair, you know, just kind of waiting and reading. You're still out there. You're partying. Yep. You're going on vacations. And the pension that you acquired 20, 30, even 40 years is not going to be substantial if you don't do something else.
Exactly. And if you don't do something else, your body will shut down on you.
Oh, absolutely.
Because it's so used to doing something else. So now you're retired and you just think you're going to sit at home for a year or two and don't do nothing. That's a year or two of money that you lost and you can't get back. I'm saying you in your 40s and you retired, go jump back into, okay, you retired from the city, go get a state job for the next 20 years. Mm-hmm. And then when you retire, you have two pensions, not one, but two pensions. How about that? Like, you don't have to worry about the civilian field just yet. You can go get a state job.
So and even if they don't want to do that, you know, I'm an advocate for entrepreneurship. Even if you don't say, hey, I want to jump into something again Monday through Friday or 40-hour work week, at least do something part-time, be creative, start yep. your own thing. Because, you know, an idle mind is the devil's workshop. Especially that contributes to a lot of mental health issues, dementia, Alzheimer's, because you're not learning anything right. else to stimulate your brain. And
right.
this was a question that I omitted in asking you. One of the things I feel very strongly about coming through the academy, after you go through the academy, there is a time when you have to go back for, what is it called? You go for your block training.
Right. Yeah, in-service training.
Yeah, in-service training, right. So when you come on the job, they do a psychological evaluation of you. And they say, hey, check the box, they're good to go. My problem and issue with the department or any other field that they don't do this, I don't know, but I can speak about correction. I feel that they need to reevaluate staff at a certain point in their career. I don't know if it's every 5 years, every 10 years, because a lot of things happen throughout your lifespan while you're working. Divorces happen. Your coworkers commit suicide. Your children pass away. The same mental state that you were in upon entry at 20, 25, 30 has now changed. Your economy, you had a divorce, your husband, your wife, you took everything. You got child support. You can't live. Like, why are we not evaluating our staff more often in a psychological review?
I think you never stop being evaluated when you are around people that pay attention. You understand what I mean? Okay. You come in every day. You're my steady officer. I see you every single day. You're cheerful, gleeful, playful, laughing, joking. Fun to be around. Now, 2 weeks later, you come in and you looking worn and tired and rugged. What's my first response to you as a first line supervisor? I'm evaluating all my officers. My job is to make sure that you're fit for duty for the day. That's why I have a roll call. I'm looking in your eyes. I'm looking at your face. I'm looking the way you dress. It's not about, oh, you got the wrong socks on. You got the wrong shoes on. Oh, your uniform is messy or you don't have the right uniform on. No, it's about looking you in your face and making sure that you are mentally ready to deal with this 8 or 16 hour day that you're about to encounter. That means you're fit for duty.
Well, that would be you.
So you never stop evaluating the individuals that you work with every single day, whether it's my coworker at the same rank of me. If you all of a sudden come in and you're down and you're depressed and it's one day and I ask you what's up and you don't want to spill a tea or you don't want to talk about it, okay, I'm going to let that go. But then the next week you coming in, you looking worse and worse. No, we're going to have a conversation because your mental state is not straight. And if you don't want to have a conversation with me, I'm going to make sure you have a conversation with HMD because you look like you need to go to HMD and talk to someone.
But see, that's what I mean. That's you doing your job, right? However, with right now in the corrections currency, captains are being just as overworked. They doing 16 hours, 4 out of 4. I don't believe that this is being done.
No, it's not, because everyone is for themselves now. So nobody is paying attention to their coworker, and then the next day you know the coworker then hung up and or went and ate their gun or something like that, and you're going, wow, I could have did more. I saw this person going through some things and I didn't bother to reach out and say, hey, are you all right? Do you want to talk about it? Do you want to? And let's be real. Some people want to gain your business just to spread your business. Okay. But then some people are actually concerned about your whereabouts, because now you're coming in. You don't care the way you smell. You don't care the way you dress. You don't care the way you look. And all of that takes a toll on your mental status. You start seeing that in a person. They change. The person that used to be all neat and tidy and cheerful is now rugged and smelly and don't care, you know. There's something going on and somebody needs to get to the bottom of that or give them a little RO time for themselves. Like, okay, you need a couple of days off, right? Because there's something going on. Okay. But now you didn't hear about them eating their gun because their wife left them and took the kids. And, you know, I had a recruit that was a twin that he was promoted to a captain too. And he ate his gun in the park. And I was devastated because he wasn't the type. He was so quiet, meek, and, you know, really to himself. He was an introvert.
But those are the ones you really have to watch out for. Them introverts.
Yeah, and I was so shocked when they told me that he ate his gun in the park because his wife was divorcing him and taking his kids. His family was his world. Right. I knew that. And I was his company commander. He wasn't married then, but he had gotten married over the years.
Right.
So I knew his family was his world. So when his world got taken from him, his thing was, why should I live? He had an exact twin. Identical twin that worked for NYPD. And wow. He worked for Correction.
Well, you know, I just pray for everyone, like I said, that's coming on. And I encourage you that are out there listening and you're still active, pay attention to your partner. You know, don't be so caught up in yourselves that you are potentially missing the signs that a person is calling out for help. Because sometimes they're not going to verbally say it to you. You know, they're not going to say, hey, I need some help. I need someone to talk to. You know, so keep your eyes open, not just for inmates, but your coworkers and your peers as well.
Yep, that's a must. When you're active, that is a must. Even when you retire, hey, a phone call or text, hey, just a check-in, what's up? Like, you have somebody on Facebook doing roll call. Okay, retirees, roll call.
Yeah, I see that.
That's fun. Like, you check in and you see everybody checking in with you. That's what it's about. We still keeping that same extended family reach. The true ones will stay true. Right. The ones that were never true will go on about their own distance life and do whatever they do best. So, but yeah, you definitely have to pay attention to people, and the signs are there. They are clear signs when people are going through some stuff.
Well, I wish them well. I'm glad the holidays are over, but don't you know, take it for granted that that's the only time. So again, I just want to thank you, Walla, for being on the show. Any last words of encouragement, or anyone that you want to shout out, or anything, you last words you want to say to the people before we go?
All females should always be taught, never accept someone telling you you can't do something. Never accept that. There's nothing in this world that you cannot do.
Point blank and the period. And on that note, we're going to say goodbye to Captain Walla. And thank you so much for being on When the Blue Comes Off. And we will see you all next week. I hope you guys enjoyed the show. And I look forward to bringing you many more, all with positive vibes. Remember, whatever you do, do it from the heart, with love and passion. Stay safe. Talk to you soon.